We know when we die, and our generation is already not the youngsters, then will be nobody here who went through it, who can say, I was there. It happened. Because you hear it today, quite a few voices already. It never happened. Never happened, they say. Now, when we, the survivors, are still here. So what will happen in 20, 50 years' time when nobody from us will be here anymore? So therefore, it is so important, this testimony, for you, for the next generation, and for the next who came, that something that show the world when you throw away the human values, what can happen? And nobody should think something, nobody is secure that something like that cannot happen. Because it can. And for no reason at all. The only reason, the only thing when it will not happen, when we will educate our youngsters to real values, to respect each other.
Thank you, everybody, for attending. I am a USC parent of three. The testimony that we just heard was from Auschwitz survivor Lily Ebert, whose grandson, Dove Foreman, will be our special guest later in the program. I am honored to participate in tonight's launch event. These stories are being kept alive because of Shoah Foundation, and hopefully through our children and many others of generations to come. I'm very proud of USC Shoah Foundation's expanded social media presence in particular, and their program to infuse Shoah Foundation's YouTube channel with new engaging content to scale their impact and help attract new viewers. Tonight, we will hear about another way that USC Shoah Foundation will be helping to view Holocaust survivor testimony from their visual history archive. Throughout the program, please feel free to post any questions that you have in the chat. There'll be time at the end where these will be answered. I'd like to introduce Dr. Corey Street, USC Shoah Foundation's Interim Executive Director, Sharon Buenos, Zikaron BaSalon's Global Director.
Thank you, Kim, so much. And I'm honored to partner with our friends at Zikaron BaSalon to welcome so many of you who are committed to helping us share these powerful stories. And we're seeing people from around the world today. And one of my favorite people all the way from Australia has joined us here today at USC's global headquarters, our board chair, Lee Lieberman. So welcome, Lee, and welcome everyone.
Thank you, Corey. Very moving to see on screen all the places around the world, people who are joining us today from far and wide, including I see a couple of Sydney-siders there. So, and I do know there's somebody from Melbourne as well, where I come from. So welcome everybody. One of the Shoah Foundation's goals right now is to make the visual history archive of 55,000 testimonies of survivors and witnesses to genocide more accessible worldwide. I am deeply honored to be here. I look forward to seeing how testimony can echo around the world in living rooms and Zoom rooms just like this one. And most particularly, I'm deeply moved once again to have Israel as a significant partner in our endeavors. Thank you for coming, everybody.
Thank you, Lee, and I'm so delighted you're here with us today. We made a promise to the 55,000 survivors who shared their stories with us that we would use them for education and action. And we have some pretty ambitious goals in that regard, including one to reach 100 million users worldwide. And we can't do that without like-minded partners who share our vision and mission, like Zikaron BaSalon, or without you, the people who have joined us today. The future of the Visual History Archive depends on thriving community connections, connected to each other and connected to the stories. We are working with Zikaron BaSalon and other organizations to put testimony in the service of remembrance, education, and action. So I'm delighted today to introduce my friend, Sharon Buenos, the Global Director of Zikaron BaSalon. Sharon, so great to be here with you today, and thank you so much for working with us to help us reach that objective.
Thank you so much, Corey, and hi, everyone. I'm extremely honored to join you from Israel today. I would also like to use my 3 minutes to thank the brilliant team of the USC Shoah Foundation. Thank you for everything you've done in the last few months to make this partnership a possibility. We are extremely proud of this partnership, and we believe that this will make a big difference in Holocaust commemoration. Zikaron BaSalon started 11 years ago with the first gathering in Israel. And in last April, we had over 1.5 million participants in 60 countries. Our initiative grew thanks to all of our guests over the years becoming hosts. Our goal is to redesign Yom HaShoah, the National Holocaust Remembrance Day, by encouraging everyone to take personal responsibility for Holocaust remembrance and giving the survivors the well-deserved stage to share their testimonies. Zikaron BaSalon is a simple action with 3 parts: a testimony by a Holocaust survivor or a second and or a third generation. It has an expressive part for guests to share their family stories and their thoughts, and a discussion to make sure that we learn from the lessons of the Holocaust and in the hope of creating a better future for all of us. Elie Wiesel, Zichro Levracha, said, "When you listen to a witness, you become a witness." And this is the essence of this partnership, making sure that all the stories of the survivors will live on for generations. Thank you.
Thank you, Sharon. And I think my name is Leslie Culp. I'm the Acting Director of Education and Outreach at USC Shoah Foundation. And I join you today to share with you these host kits to be able to bring testimonies into your living rooms to be used, even living rooms into your homes around the world. Now, these kits are meant to provide discussion prompts connected to each story. And these initial kits feature 7 testimonies from different experiences. They come in English, Spanish, and Hebrew. And we hope as our partnership continues to expand the availability of those languages. They are edited down from our 2.5 hour testimonies to about 30 to 45 minutes. And we also have access to the full testimonies as well. Of these 7, 2 of the survivors are still alive. Now, in terms of how we engage with these testimonies to have these conversations and these discussions, the kits themselves, these host kits, provide scaffolding, discussion topics, and other resources to be used to supplement the discussions. And they're geared for all ages so that the entire family and friends can also have these conversations. Now, Sharon shared, it opens with an introduction of the program, ideas about how to host an event, how to make it meaningful, how to provide a safe, open, and engaged event. And it opens this way. So you're provided with information about how to host these conversations and these viewings. Now, prior to listening to the testimonies and engaging in the discussion, the kit provides an important, an opening question. Why? And I think this is why we are also here. Why is it important to learn about this history and to learn about it from survivors? So I can get that first picture of what these kits look like. In a second, my screen. Perfect. So you can see here, it opens with, it provides, so you'll see the host kit here. It provides biographical and historical background for the testimony to contextualize it and to center it in the time frame so that we understand who we are engaging with in this testimony. It provides some of that background. Then we listen to the testimony. We go on to the next slide. And after you listen to the testimony, you spend some time, you're followed by an open space and an ability to be able to, to have some time for personal expression. Attendees could talk about their connections, their families. They could bring readings, read a poem, do a performance. But it's really an opportunity to make and bridge that personal connection we bring to the table with these survivors with whom we engage through testimony. And then it's followed by a discussion question. So we can go to the next slide. Now these questions here are about, they come in 2 parts. One is about the history to explore and understand the story that is shared in the testimony. And then it's followed with questions connected to our days, to today, to discuss the universal lessons and applications to today and to tomorrow. And then towards the end there, you also see questions to go home with. So the conversation doesn't end there, it continues on. And the idea is that we continue day to day, year to year, to think about the lessons, the stories that are shared with us about the experience, and then ultimately our personal responsibility for how we are moving with the story. And now briefly, through the education department here at USC Shoah Foundation, we know and we understand that testimony changes attitudes and behaviors. Now, it's not a substitute for survivors, so that can never be, but it does have an impact. In fact, in one of our studies that we did, I think in 2019, where we looked at we surveyed over 2,000 college students who had learned about the Holocaust in high school. And what we learned is that those that engaged with testimony had the most transformative learning and carried that learning with them. Their critical thinking deepened, their empathy deepened, their capacity for empathy deepened, their understanding for the importance of diversity and inclusion, and their understanding of pluralism deepened because of the engagement with these testimonies and with these stories. So we know the impact is transformative. And this will be especially important once survivors are no longer able to tell their stories and share them with us. We have here at the Institute are making these testimonies available in perpetuity, as we say, they are here to last so that generations ahead of us continue to be able to engage with these stories. So now I'd like to give you a preview of what you will be hearing from the survivors. I'd like to play a clip from Erica Gold's testimony. Erica was born in 1928 in Germany and was 5 years old when Hitler came to power and was 17 years old at the end of the war when she moved to the United States. That was a special occasion. We are honored today to have Erica's daughter, Deb Miller, in the audience, as well as Erica's interviewer, Nancy Fisher. Nancy has concluded over 150 interviews from USC Shoah Foundation, and Erica was her first. So let's listen to Erica's message.
What was your favorite room in the house as a child?
The living room, because it had a stove in the middle. And especially in the winter time, after I when I would take the sled and would go sleigh riding, and my mother would make hot chocolate. And that was one of my favorite rooms. She would welcome me with her warmth.
What activities do you remember doing inside that house? What were your favorite things?
Well, we had the Shabbat on Friday evening, which was, my mother was a religious woman, and she prepared all day for that evening. The candles were lit, the table was set, the chair was, there was always an empty chair for welcoming guests who were either going through the village or were poor and didn't have a place where to eat. And so it was always a very wonderful, warm feeling, because she would cook, gefilled the fish, and bake, and it was just great. I always looked forward for Friday evenings.
Quite appropriate that she talks about her favorite room being the living room. And really, this is what we are inviting you all to do with this program, is to bring these stories into your living room and have these conversations. So to introduce our other survivors, I'd like to invite Jamie Perlstein to tell us a bit about the other survivors whose testimonies will be used in the salons. Jamie?
Hello, everyone, and thank you, Leslie. I am pleased to introduce you to the other survivors that will be featured in the salons. In total, we have seven survivors, seven from the Holocaust, but five in English and one in Spanish and one in Hebrew. And we selected these testimonies based on a variety of experiences. We will be featuring Agnes Adachi. Agnes was born in 1918 in Budapest. In 1944, she joined Swedish diplomat Raoul Wallenberg and took an active part in rescue operations to save fellow Jews. After the war, she settled in Philadelphia, married, and had two sons. We'll also be featuring Ellie Alevi. Ellie, whose testimony will be provided in Spanish, was born in Greece in 1926. After liberation, he worked as a United Nations Relief and Works Agency aid worker and ultimately immigrated to Chile. A special thank you to USC Shoah Foundation's Next Generation Council member, Aliza Lieberman, for promoting Zikaron BaSalon salons and the use of Ellie's testimony in Latin America. Next, we have Yehuda Bacon. Yehuda was born in Czechoslovakia in 1929. After liberation, he returned home before immigrating to Israel. Yehuda, who is still alive, works in Jerusalem as a painter and graphic artist. Joseph Bau. Joseph, whose testimony will be provided in Hebrew, was born in Poland in 1920. He received a place on Schindler's List during the war. And following the war, he immigrated to Israel and had a long career as an artist, an illustrator, and an author. A Zikaron BaSalon salon featuring Joseph's testimony will be held in his honor at the Joseph Bau House Museum in Tel Aviv. This will be the first time that Joseph's testimony will be shown there. Kurt Thomas. Kurt was born in Czechoslovakia in 1914. After escaping from Sobibor death camp, he was hidden by a family for 9 months until liberation. Kurt eventually emigrated to the United States. His full testimony that he gave to the USC Shoah Foundation is 6.5 hours long. And last but not least, Edith Eva Eger. Edith was born in 1927 in Czechoslovakia and spent time in several concentration camps with her sister. After the war, Edith moved back to Czechoslovakia and was married. In 1949, she and her husband emigrated to the United States, and she became a world-famous psychologist specializing in post-traumatic stress and also a well-known best-selling author. I would now like to play a clip for you from Edith's testimony that was recorded in 1995.
To be a survivor is to be flexible, to bend, and not to be rigid. So to me, hatred breeds hatred, and I have no time to hate. I don't forget what happened to me. I may not even overcome that. I think I came to terms with it, and I was able to integrate. Took me 40 years, and I'm still not done. And I don't live in Auschwitz. Part of me was left in Auschwitz, but not the better part, not the bigger part. I think I'm capable of having joy and passion and live a full life. I gave the Nazis my health, my talent as a ballerina. They could not rob me, but I couldn't dance after I came back. My parents, my grandparents. So why would I give them another inch? And so to me, this is the way I commit myself to life and to healing, by opening up communications between parents and children, and as a psychologist and a family and a sex therapist. I feel very good that I am able to carry the word that my parents didn't die in vain. And I am very, very, very grateful that this interview is taking place, that I'm sitting here and knowing that this story is going to be heard again, and my children and grandchildren will know that Grandma, a long, long time ago, was a victim, but today she's a survivor.
My name is Esther Toporek-Finder, the daughter of two Holocaust survivors from Lask, Poland. I am the president of the Holocaust Survivors Group of Southern Nevada and Generations of the Shoah Nevada, and a founder of Generations of the Shoah International GSI, the largest Holocaust survivor family group. GSI reaches tens of thousands of members with our monthly e-newsletter and social media. We also serve as the bridge between the international and intergenerational survivor community and the major Holocaust organizations and institutions around the world. I have done oral histories for both the USC Shoah Foundation and the US Holocaust Memorial Museum. It was my honor and privilege to interview over 200 survivors. It is always a pleasure to hear Dr. Eber. It is so important to hear the authentic voices of those who were eyewitnesses to history. Eyewitness testimony is powerful and impactful. Growing up, I heard many moving stories of survival from my parents, their siblings, and their friends. As an adult, I worked to record these histories to preserve them for generations to come. My mother died before we had the technology to record survivor testimonies that we have today. We do not have her story recorded. We don't even have the sound of her voice. But my father gave testimony to the Shoah Foundation, so I am still able to introduce him to students, even though he is no longer with us. The heartbreaking reality is there are fewer and fewer survivors who can speak. We are lucky to have the USC Shoah Foundation and the priceless interviews they have collected. Now, working with Zikaron BaSalon, the first person accounts of survival can be shared with new audiences around the world today and into the future. Now I'd like to introduce you to Tova Dorfman.
Thank you, Esther. I'm also very deeply honored to be here as the daughter of two Holocaust survivors and a sibling of a Holocaust survivor whose widow, also a survivor, is alive and well at age 98 and living in Miami. My mother was interviewed for the USC Shoah Foundation testimonials in 1997. And in a sense, all this came full circle when I assumed the position of the deputy chair of the World Zionist Organization and the chair of the Department for Israel and Holocaust Remembrance Worldwide. We at the World Zionist Organization teamed up with Zikaron BaSalon in the belief that it's now more crucial than ever to make the stories of survivors accessible to many audiences, especially to young people. The
The guiding sentence was for us, what is our world going to look like when the headline will read, the last Holocaust survivor has passed away? Hosting salons with survivors and second and third generation family members is therefore so crucial. Using media, particularly social media, to tell the story drove us to create 6M followers, a project together with Zikaron BaSalon, which we launched on International Holocaust Remembrance Day, which connects social media influencers with survivors and works with them to manage their platforms on Instagram and on TikTok in order to reach millions of followers by next International Holocaust Remembrance Day. And we are reaching out today to survivors and their families to be part of this initiative. We've also connected with university film students who are interested in using testimonials in hosting salons. It is my belief and the strategy of our department at the World Zionist Organization that we have a narrow window of time and we must therefore act now and creatively. Now more than ever before, it's important to share with the world the stories of the survivors. Thank you.
Thank you, Esther, and thank you, Tova. Now I get to introduce Deb Foreman, who is a fourth generation survivor and our special guest, who is absolutely inspiring. I personally am never on TikTok, but somehow found my way to him and actually called Janie and said, I'm not sure if we can ever become lucky enough to somehow get to reach out, but somehow we did. So thank you so much personally, because it's a total honor to have you here. We are going to get to learn how he took his great-grandmother's testimony, the survivor Lily Ebert's story, and how it's gone viral, and it's attracted more than 50 million views. So it is my pleasure to introduce social media sensation and USC Foundation's young spokesman, Deb Foreman.
Thank you very much, and good afternoon, everyone. Thank you so much for being here today for this launch of this very exciting and a new partnership and program for you to participate in commemorating Yom HaShoah this year. Being a member of what is known as the fourth generation is a huge part of my identity. As mentioned, in recent years, I've had the privilege of speaking alongside my incredible great-grandmother about her harrowing Holocaust testimony, and I know that she is nothing short of remarkable. I still find it hard to comprehend all that she went through during the Holocaust, and to the courage and determination that she has shown throughout her life. Now I work with my great-grandmother to educate others about the Holocaust. We tell people across the world about Lily's happy childhood, her wonderful parents and siblings, and how it all changed when the Nazis invaded Hungary almost exactly 78 years ago in March 1944. We tell people about Auschwitz-Birkenau, slave labor camps, concentration and extermination camps. We tell people about how entire communities were destroyed. We tell people how my great-grandmother is lucky that some of her family survived, because in other places, no one was left to remember or to mourn. We tell people about my great-grandmother's move to Israel, about how she rebuilt her life, and we tell people about how proud she is of her large and loving family now. We try to educate people all the time. We currently have over 1.9 million followers on TikTok, and we use social media to teach the next generation, my generation. In 2020, my great-grandmother and I wrote our best-selling and international award-winning book, Lily's Promise, which is being published in the US by HarperCollins this May, so that even more people across the world could read Lily's story and to learn from the past. We were especially honored that His Royal Highness Prince Charles wrote the foreword to Lily's Promise. He wrote movingly about the need to transform history into memory. And he said, for the Jewish people, the Holocaust was a personal tragedy. By the end of the Second World War, 2/3 of European Jewry had perished at the hands of the Nazis. 6 million innocent Jewish men, women, and children murdered for no other reason other than the religion they were born into. A great pillar of smoke covered all of Europe, the shadow of which still remains with us today. The Holocaust was also a universal human tragedy. It was the greatest crime of man against man, during which humanity showed itself capable of incomparable inhumanity on an incomprehensible scale. Names replaced with numbers, tattooed on forearms as a permanent reminder of the depths to which humankind can sink to, and the evil which it can impart on a fellow human being. The Holocaust is a unique and dark period in history, but its lessons are universal. We need to remember, and we need to always speak out. We must always take a stand against injustice and intolerance wherever we see it in society. Because if we don't keep remembering, and if we don't keep speaking out, we can never change the future. Working with my great grandmother over the past few years to educate about her testimony has been so special. And I've learned more about her than I ever knew before. She really is a true inspiration. Today, we are here preparing to mark Yom HaShoah. Every year on Yom HaShoah, people come together to remember the victims of the Holocaust. It is now more important than ever that we listen to the survivors like my great grandmother and internalize their stories and transform them from history into memory. We must remember their stories and take the time to remember those who are no longer able to speak for themselves. The theme for this year's Holocaust Memorial Day in the United Kingdom was One Day. My great grandmother knew that if she survived Auschwitz, she would tell the world about what happened to her and her family. She knew that one day in her future, she would be called on to become a witness. And I know that one day in my future, I will carry on her legacy. I will be her witness to the next generation. At a similar age to me, my great grandmother was deported to Auschwitz-Birkenau, along with her mother, younger brother, and three of her sisters. They traveled in cattle trucks, and the conditions were indescribable. Very quickly, people began to die. 5 days later, they arrived at the ramp of Auschwitz-Birkenau. My great grandmother's mother, youngest sister, and brother were sent straight to the gas chambers by Dr. Mengele. She never saw them again. My great grandmother still finds it hard to talk about Auschwitz. How do you describe a factory of death, a place of industrial killing, she asks me. Hundreds of members of her extended family were murdered during the Holocaust. She told me what happened, and I am telling you what took place, because they cannot. Zikaron BaSalon provides a unique opportunity to take a small but simple action, and at the same time, be a part of something bigger and very meaningful. You can become a witness and create a space for other people to become witnesses too. I am very much looking forward to hosting my own Zikaron BaSalon meeting for Yom HaShoah this year, together with the Israeli ambassador at her residency in the United Kingdom. By creating a space for discussion and conversation, focusing on the lessons learned from the Holocaust, we hope to combat anti-Semitism and encourage social action, recommitting ourselves to the belief set out in the Jewish law of Tikkun Olam, repairing the world. In January 2019, I visited a Jewish orphanage in Ukraine with school. Memories of that trip will stay with me forever. One particular memory was watching the children, over 400 orphans, preparing for the Jewish Shabbat and singing together. How sad it is now to think of those same children escaping war, leaving their home behind and taking only one bag with them, starting again in a new country. As we see this terrible situation in Ukraine, we must show that we have learned the lessons from the passivity of those during the Holocaust. It is impossible to remain silent whilst once again, innocent people are being killed. As Elie Wiesel says, neutrality helps the oppressor, never the oppressed. Silence encourages the tormentor, never the tormented. This unique opportunity, this Yom HaShoah, will allow you, the audience today listening, to ensure that you do not stay silent. You will become the witness of the next generation, and you'll create a space where others can too. Thank you very much.
I am speechless. This is the first time that I heard Dove speak, and all I could say is we are so grateful, Dove, for your inspirational message, and also so grateful that you are our first USC Shoah Foundation Young Spokesperson, and I look forward as the Acting Director of Community Engagement and Outreach Programming to work with you for a long time on many, many more projects. So thank you. I'm sure that people have questions for you, and please post them in the chat. So my role now is what we call the call to action. Hopefully you were all inspired and educated by tonight's program. The important next step is very simple. We encourage you to please, please sign up to host a salon. What this means, as you heard, is that you will receive a packet with a testimony. The testimony will be 30 to 45 minutes long. You can host the salon either in your home or virtually. In the packet will be all the instructions. There will be discussion questions. It's basically very easy to follow. And it's a perfect way to not only take ownership of a survivor story, but to invite your friends or your family, or if you're an educator, your students, your synagogue members, to also take ownership and responsibility for that survivor story. Our goal is, on top of the 1.5 million that Sharon reaches, which is incredible, our goal is to have 500 salons using testimony. You're welcome to do the salon at any time, although the bulk of them are typically held around Yom HaShoah, the week from Sunday to Sunday, with Yom HaShoah being in the middle, and this year it's April 27th. Once you sign up, and you'll see in the chat, there's a link to the form. You'll get information and you'll get your kit. At this point, I just wanted to say thank you, first of all, to our partners, Sharon and your team at Zikaron BaSalon. This is a partnership that I've heard about for a long time and that we've wanted to do for a long time. And I am just thrilled that we now have made it a reality. I also wanted to thank the USC Shoah Foundation team. And I probably will forget someone if I mention them, but this project was all hands on deck, and from the education team who came up with the questions to the team that selected the testimonies and edited the testimonies, to our communications team, to our media team, to our executive office, to our advancement team that we always partner with. I just wanted to say thank you. This is a partnership that we are extremely proud of. It kicks off a very intense community service effort that we will be focused on in the coming year. And what we really want to do is have all of you connect with testimony and connect with each other. With that, I'm going to ask all of our panelists to join us again, and we will open it up for questions and answers. I know that we have some questions in the chat, and then you could continue to ask them. So we have with us Corey and Lee, and the questions could be about the program, it could be about our work in general, about Zikaron's work. We have Sharon with us, and Kim and Leslie, and Dove, I'm just making sure, Tova and Dove and Esther. Okay. So the first question from Danielle, how can I help? What can I do? Sharon, I think this one's for you.
The easiest thing will be to host a salon, to sign up, get a kit and host a salon, but also help us spread the word. Dove, I also want to acknowledge your words and what you've said. And I'm so proud that you are part of this partnership, and thank you. I actually had the pleasure and the honor of meeting your great grandma in London a few times. So I feel very, very privileged. So to help, sign up and get the word out. This is the best that we can do.
Thank you. There's also a question in the chat, and Sharon, I think this is for you, but also for Leslie. Is there a recommended age for those who join salons? I'm wondering if this is appropriate for teenagers. Leslie, maybe you want to talk?
Sure.
I'll start off. And yes, they are. We were conscientious about the information, the testimonies that are brought into the homes and how they were chosen and edited. Again, you do have access to the full testimonies, but the particular editing is meant for accessibility across ages so that teenagers especially, I see the question there, teenagers especially can also have these conversations and discussions as they are developing their understanding of the world. I would highly recommend that you bring them into the conversation.
And now, of course, there's a couple questions for Dove. Dove, how can we ensure that the Holocaust isn't forgotten by your generation? And that's from Marilyn.
I think it's the million dollar question, as they say. I'm doing history A level, which is the highest level of history that you can do in secondary school in the UK. And I completely understand why many young people don't want to learn about the Holocaust or history in general. When you're learning it out of a textbook, it's very hard to actually understand what happens, but also to become interested by it. It's very hard to understand what the number 6 million actually means. But when you actually hear one person's story, when you focus in and realize, wow, they actually lived a very similar life to the life that I lived. And I think that's what me and my great grandmother tried to do in our book. We tried to show that she lived a very normal life before the war, and it could have been anyone else. They lived a normal life, and with one click of a finger, really overnight in Hungary, everything changed. And I think the only way to ensure that the Holocaust is not forgotten amongst my generation is to ensure that we put faces on the stories. And I think that there's no better place to say this than in a meeting with the USC Shoah Foundation, because that's what they do. And that's what they've tried to do for so many years. And I think the only way to continue to this work is to go onto social media, or not even just on social media, but all over, and ensure that we put faces to these testimonies. And we don't just say that 6 million died. We say, for example, it was Lily Ebbett's family. It was, and I think that's the only way. You've got to make it personable. And that's the only way that we can ensure that my generation and people my age are going to be interested.
The question, how soon will we receive the kit? So Sharon, I know that you're working on this.
By early next week. So if you can sign up today, and by early next week, you will get it in your email.
And yes, the salons could be either virtual or live. So you'll get the abbreviated 30 to 45 minute testimony, and it's up to you. Tova, this is a question for you. How can people support the 6 million followers project?
Well, first of all, they can follow the survivors that we already have on the page itself. But beyond that, we are working with Zikaron BaSalon to connect people who want to manage social media accounts for survivors or survivors' families that want to get the stories out there. And we will also provide some guidance for together with Zikaron BaSalon to do that. So if you connect with us, we can make that match happen. And we've already been doing that. We just had 25 social media influencers in Israel. We have millions of followers, and we're connecting them to survivors in their local communities. So we're very much following the path of Dove that he launched and started.
This is a question about USC Shoah Foundation social media presence. And Corey, hopefully you can help with that. We heard in Kim's remarks that USC Shoah Foundation is doing something with their YouTube presence. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Sure. Thanks, Jania. Thanks for the question. What a great one it is. We've been really looking at how we utilize YouTube and the algorithms that are play there to get more access for individuals who are following us there. We know that people are coming there, they're finding their testimonies on our channel. So we're working with a great company to develop some new examples of media and resources of clips around themes so that we can increase our access there. So it's a completely new approach to utilizing YouTube and some of our other social media channels and making sure that those are all integrated. So check out the channel if you haven't seen it. And we are welcoming feedback to see how we're doing.
And this is actually a question from me for Esther. So Esther, I know that your community is predominantly 2G. And whenever I ask you, how many people do you reach? You always say to me, it's the networks of other organizations that we reach. Can you just tell us a little bit more about what other organizations you work with? And I know it's hard to give numbers, but what your reach is and how you reach the other 2G.
Well, we're actually not primarily second generation. We are intergenerational and international. Excuse me, I have a cold. We send out a monthly e-newsletter that goes around the world. And just by way of example, it gets picked up by the Association of Holocaust Organizations listserv. So it goes to all the major Holocaust organizations and institutions on this planet. So everybody gets it, and it's dedicated to sharing information and resources. And we really don't know how many people we reach. We know we have thousands of people on Facebook, but we basically have source control. We send out the newsletter, and then it goes everywhere.
Thank you. There's a question in the chat. Will the links be included in the email with the kit? And there will be the links. Also, there will be a link to the full testimony. And there was another question earlier, if these could be used in a public place like at a synagogue. And the answer is yes, that if you wanted to do an event at your synagogue, just like they're doing at Joseph Bowes Museum in Israel, you're more than welcome to do that as well. There was a question about, can we have testimonies, can we select testimonies to use? So the answer to that is hopefully one day, yes. What we're doing, and this is a pilot program, is that we selected 7 testimonies to represent a variety of experiences, because we want to make sure that people hear from child survivors. And as you heard, someone who was saved by Raoul Wallenberg and someone who was on Schindler's List. The goal of this program going forward is that we'll continue to add more and more testimony from our archive, so that there will be an even greater array of stories to be told and survivors to be heard from. But what we do encourage is that if you have your own story or your family story, your grandmother, your grandfather, there's a part of the salon which is about expression. And what we encourage you to do is at that point to please bring that story, your family story, alive. And we can provide you, someone asked about testimonies in Australia. What we could certainly do is provide you with information, how many testimonies we have that were taken in Australia. If you have a family member who's in the archive, we are more than happy to send you a link to their testimony so that you could refer to it. So that's for now how it will work. And hopefully as time goes on, there will be more testimonies. There's a question for Tova. I think we're going to handle this offline. It's about actually someone in your family and connecting with someone in your family. Corey, this isn't a question from the audience, but I think that this is interesting and it's connected. As you know, Sharon obviously still works with many, many survivors, as do many of the people on this program. Can you talk a little bit about what we're doing with our Last Chance collection and how we're continuing to take testimony?
Yeah, thanks, Jenny. We are taking this opportunity to really scour worldwide to get those individuals who haven't yet given their testimonies, or even those individuals who would like to add on. These are really important moments to gather the testimonies that we still have an opportunity to do. So this is a global endeavor. We're working with partners all over the world. We have a list currently of individuals who have been identified or identified that they would like to have their testimonies taken, and we are working through that list as quickly as possible. This is also about using current cameras, but also giving them an opportunity to talk about current events and the experiences that they've had, even a longer horizon since the Holocaust. So we are looking forward to bringing in a number of new testimonies over the next several months, as we've got a real pause and we're able to get back into people's homes. But we're also working with great partners like Nancy and others in New York to bring people to a single space. So we are interested in doing this. And if you've got someone in your family or you need to contact us, Rachel will put the link into the chat so that we can get those testimonies taken through our last chance testimony collection program. So please be in touch. Please share that information widely so we can continue this important work.
There's just a couple more questions about the logistics of the salon. And then, because I'm conscious of the time, I'll ask Kim to come back in to wrap it up. The next question is, what is the specific number of participants that you recommend for the salon? Well, Sharon, I know you can answer that in terms of salons in people's homes, because you've been doing that for 10 years at Zikaron BaSalon. So do you want to start with in-person, and then maybe I could jump in about virtual?
It's about, it's as many as you feel comfortable hosting in your home or in your balcony or in your garden, making sure that you still keep the intimacy. Now with COVID, obviously, we might have some restrictions, so we have to keep that in mind. But the salon can be with your family. It can be with your 50 closest friends or with your friends from college. So it's at the end of the day, it's up to you. We recommend between 15 to 40.
And in terms of virtual, I mean, my thought is as many as could fit on one screen. And I think that people's Zooms are different, but that's my thought, so that it still feels intimate, although it's virtual.
I will say up to 25 on Zoom.
And there's one last question. How often will the 7 testimonies be updated? So this is an annual program, mostly done around Yom HaShoah. So if all is well, we will continue next year, and hopefully we will every year add more and more testimonies. Is there a recommended age? I think we talked about this, but yes, middle schoolers, teenagers, certainly college students, obviously adults. So with that, we're going to wrap up. I just wanted to say thank you to everyone. I want to bring Kim back in. Don't go. We have a surprise at the end that I think you'll really enjoy. And thank you all. And just reach out to us if you have any questions at all. And please, please sign up to host a salon. Kim.
Thank you, everybody, for coming. We're going to end with a message from Edith Eger, and she taped it this week, and it was done 27 years after giving her initial interview and her testimony with USC's Shoah Foundation. So thank you again.
My name is Dr. Edith Eva Eger. I am most grateful to the Shoah Foundation, the USC Shoah Foundation, to be able to do everything, anything that we can, that will never ever happen to us, to anyone, when good people do terrible things. And so I am here at 94, letting you know that everything that you contribute, I truly appreciate more and more, because together we're going to be much stronger than me alone or you alone. Our ancestors were slaves. They already also were walking, I understand, over 40 years, and they never gave up. And I carry that blood, and hopefully you do too, that we never give up. I was able to also talk to 100,000 people in Ukraine, not be ever giving in and giving up. And these are most wonderful patriots that I support. So I wish you well. Happy Passover. Much love to you. Shalom.